Welcome everyone to today's installment of our Hedge Fund Nuts and Bolts series. Today we're going to be talking about seed investors. So I'm David Vaughn. I am the head of our U.S. private funds practice here at Dechert, which encompasses both hedge funds and private equity and really everything in between. We do a lot of fund formation as well as regulatory work in the U.S. out of our New York, Boston, Washington, D.C., Orange County, and San Francisco offices, as well as internationally in London, Luxembourg, Dublin, in Paris, in Germany, and in Dubai, Singapore, and Hong Kong, all have fund formation practices as well as regulatory expertise in the space, as well as working with seed investors. I'm joined today by two of my partners. I'm joined by Josh Milgram, who's a tax partner in our New York office. His practice includes providing tax advice and planning for investment funds and advisors in the hedge fund and private equity sectors, partnership and corporate taxation, as well as advising on the tax aspects of domestic and cross-border M&A, capital markets, and restructuring transactions. I'm also joined by Will Tuttle, who's a corporate partner in our Washington office. He focuses practice on capital markets and general corporate matters, including the representation of investment advisors on the structuring and formation of their businesses and strategic transactions involving financial services firms. I split my time between New York and Washington, so I'm sort of the bridge between the two geographies here today. So why don't we go ahead and start the presentation, just do a brief introduction on what we mean by seed investments. This covers a very wide range of possible arrangements you could have for a newly formed or emerging manager, where the people who come to them first as kind of anchor or seed investors will help them get their business off the ground. The seed investor, sort of in exchange for being early to the arrangement, as well as really helping the manager get started or expand their business, can benefit either from fee terms or even economics in the manager's business. And there's a wide variety of the arrangements these things could be presented as. So this presentation, we're really just kind of giving an overview of seed arrangements and other considerations when you're contemplating these arrangements. One thing that we get a question about a lot is what is sort of market terms, and I would say there's a complete range because the actual benefits the seed provider is bringing vary quite a bit, and so the economic terms will vary quite a bit as well. But we'll get into that more as we go through the presentation. So now we'll go on to the next slide, and I will pass it over to Will.
Thank you, David. We thought it would be helpful to start by giving an overview of some common sources of seed capital. The first one that comes to the mind of most managers is a group of alternative investment managers that specialize in seeding emerging managers. And we've listed a few prominent examples on the list. The benefit of these types of managers is that they're very knowledgeable with the space. They're familiar with terms and how to structure these deals. They also potentially offer greater speed to execution than some of the other alternatives. The potential downside to one of these managers is, in fact, one of the pros, which is the level of their knowledge and the sophistication can really lead to less flexibility on terms and frankly, term sheets that may have a bigger ask on the part of the manager than some of the other sources of seed capital. The next option that we often spend time exploring are arrangements with family offices. These can offer the benefit of a little more flexibility with respect to how arrangements are structured and what the terms might be. The downside is sometimes these processes will move a little slower, and there can be more of an education process of what the manager is intending to do, how the fund docs might work, how the documents governing the investment manager might work. And David was actually mentioning to me earlier today that there was actually an article earlier this week that sort of highlighted family office considerations.
It was right up in Forbes saying that because of the performance of the hedge fund space being a little off the last few years, but some of the smaller funds performing, a lot of family offices have gotten more active in working with emerging and startup managers. And it's an area where I think some of the big institutions outside of the sort of specialized alternative managers have been a little reluctant for the last 5 or 10 years to get as involved as they had been, so the family offices seem to be stepping into that market opportunity.
Another potential option for the seed capital is a prior employer from which the emerging manager is being spun out. The pro is that there's obviously knowledge of the team being spun out, what their strategy is, so you may see a little less diligence on that front. The con is that if there's a desire to leave for other business reasons, it can be a very difficult arrangement to try to structure, because you effectively have to put the cart before the horse and have a discussion with someone about the prospect that you might be leaving and you might like their help in leaving, which, you know, depending on the relationship and who the manager is and how, sort of what their institutional philosophy is, may or may not go over particularly well. And then the final option, which we've seen a little more of recently, is simply large institutional investors with whom the manager has a relationship. You know, someone who was a large investor in a flagship fund that developed a good relationship with the portfolio manager. The portfolio manager chooses to lead and reaches out to that large institutional investor.
They certainly see that, and I think the relationship is key there, because a lot of these institutions we see investing in startup managers where they've got a prior relationship don't typically invest in a fund right off the bat. So somebody's first fund or without a track record built up in the new fund, it's often difficult to get that institutional money. But if the manager in a prior role has a relationship with the institution, there's more flexibility typically in getting into the newer funds.
Does that ever raise non-solicit issues?
It is important. I think we always have to look at what obligations the portfolio manager has when he or she leaves their prior employer, right? There's always the question of, do they have a non-solicit for investors, other employees, and importantly, do they have a right to use the track record and enough backup to satisfy the SEC requirements in being able to substantiate the track record? Because, of course, people tend to like to see a track record for these new managers.
The next set of slides deals with potential benefits to the manager of entering into a seed relationship. And this first slide focuses a little more on the fund side of the spectrum. And a key benefit there is that a large initial investment into one or more of the funds or accounts, which may be enough to begin implementation of the manager's strategy. This may or may not be enough on its own to actually launch a fund or to get a manager to profitability, but it's a huge first step and maybe a way to sort of minimize losses while other fundraising efforts continue. Another key advantage is the lockup of the investment of the seeder, which is often 2 to 4 years, is generally considered to be enough time to enable the manager to create a track record and begin implementation of an investment plan. Although it's clearly not permanent capital, it can give some good flexibility with respect to investment in some less liquid assets that may be able to be realized within that span of 2 to 4 years.
Yeah, and historically, we've seen that to get the institutional money we were talking about before, that historically it's been very important to have at least a 2 or 3 year track record in order to be able to convince people that they've got the operational and performance-related adjustments so that they have that proof so the institutional investors can get in. So the seed investor kind of bridges you to that when you're trying to create that track record.
And I think one of the other advantages is it's generally viewed as being a harder lockup than a soft lockup, meaning that the capital really is there absent really egregious circumstances, as opposed to just a gentleman's agreement that the capital would stay or that no one intends to withdraw it. That being said, there are obvious circumstances in which the seeder will want the opportunity to be able to cancel the lockup for certain cause events. Importantly, bad performance should not fall into the basket of cause. This is really focused more on the departure of key individuals, allegations of fraud, convictions, or other real disqualifying events.
Well, the hard and soft lockup, so the hard lockup is usually a contractual obligation. The soft lockup would be an exit could, or your withdrawal or redemption could be affected, but subject to a fee that goes back to the fund. Where you don't have even traditional seed investors, you'll see early investors sometimes get early bird specials where there'll be more of a soft lockup. So if you're in within the first 6 or 12 months of the fund and you agree to not withdraw without paying a pretty substantial fee for a couple of years, that's also something that people sometimes do and call a soft lockup, even if it's not a formal seating arrangement.
And then on the next slide, we discuss a little bit of the benefits of the startup assistance that a seater may be able to provide. I think this generally comes into to a couple of categories. The first is simply a cash contribution to the advisor that allows for initial operating capital. It enables the hiring of staff, build out of systems, and other items. This can sometimes allow a manager to build out scale before the assets under management would suggest that that scale can actually be obtained. Particularly when you are dealing with an alternative investment manager that specializes in seeding arrangements, there may be arrangements in which the seeder puts you in contact with their service providers, which can give you an advantage of pre-negotiated rates, pre-negotiated forms, and also those that institutional managers may be able to directly provide office space for technology and other support at presumably relatively competitive, you know, market-based rates.
And I think these sorts of arrangements with the back office have, I think, have been driven to be even more important than they were, you know, 5 or 10 years ago by a couple of different dynamics in the market that have made the need to have a good back office and middle office technology and infrastructure very important for establishing a successful, you know, hedge fund launch. The first is just there are more requirements than there used to be. With SEC registration and other reporting requirements, there is sort of a critical mass of compliance infrastructure which wasn't really necessary before, just an incremental cost, but if you're in a startup mode where you're kind of barely a break even with your assets, every little bit of expense there does make a difference. And so that's been, I think, something that people have looked to. Also, institutional investors, even family offices in kind of a post-Madoff, post-crisis world, have been much more focused on infrastructure that the managers have. If you look at some of the statistics and stories you hear about failures of hedge funds, obviously having a you know, dismal performance is a big one, but a lot of managers with good performance have been caught up in back office problems and reporting problems where investors have lost confidence in them. And so it's definitely a business risk that you need to have, you know, a reasonably built out platform when you start the new business. And sometimes, depending on the critical mass, this is a real benefit to the managers because they have that infrastructure that investors can be comfortable with and frankly will be, you know, well designed for their strategies.
And then the final category of startup assistance falls into the formal and informal advice category. And this can include things such as service on an advisory board, being available for consultations, being able to review business plans, or even depending on the rights that are negotiated, there may be certain approval rights over budgets and other strategic developments on the business. And the final set of benefits to the manager focus on the fundraising element and locking down a large seeder at the early stages can have the very meaningful potential to increase fundraising efforts in future discussions. Again, there's both a formal and an informal process to it. On the more formal side, where there's a broker-dealer arm, you may be able to be put on the platform of products that are being reviewed through that broker-dealer arm. That can help to amass assets both towards a first close and also as you work through subsequent closings and sort of hit key thresholds for the AUM. There's also the more informal side of making introductions to prospective investors and the fact that being able to say we are backed by manager XYZ and we met their rigorous diligence standards, their operational standards, our investment strategy was something that they believed in, can have a meaningful reputational value in conversations with prospective investors.
One thing to keep in mind as you get into the marketing side of this, and this goes somewhat to the terms of the seed arrangement, we note there that if you have a broker-dealer arm, you can clearly do the marketing that the seeder does. They can clearly do the marketing. There's a bit of a gray area on broker-dealer registration if the seeder is not registered with the broker-dealer, doesn't have an affiliate to place through. You know, there's an issuer exemption that pretty clearly works for the portfolio manager and the fund itself. it gets to be more of a gray area when it's the seeder, and depending upon the level of their activities, they may have a trigger of a broker-dealer issue for themselves, something that the SEC had been, announced a couple of years ago they were looking at, and something that there's some uncertainty about now. But one of the important things as we go through the terms is to remember that one of the issues on broker-dealer registration that they look at is any form of compensation. So long story short, if you're not a registered broker-dealer, you probably don't want to be getting commissions for raising capital if you're a seeder. But beyond that, you're into kind of a gray area you need to think about. And on to due diligence. So what kinds of things will a seeder do before they'll agree to commit capital, right? So this is sort of the due diligence you typically see and things to think about and be ready for if you approach a seed investor or an organization that has done this typically. The first one, of course, is reviewing the track record of the principals and key employees. And this can be an issue, as we mentioned earlier, about somebody who's leaving a firm and whether they have the right to that track record, or whether they have any contractual obligations that might limit their ability to use the track record, whether it be confidentiality or direct obligations in an employment agreement, for example, with their current employer about the use of the track record. There are also SEC issues. If you're moving from one firm to another, there are a lot of questions about whether the track record is really belongs to the individuals who are leaving and can be portrayed as their track record, particularly if not the entire team is moving. If you have sort of a mix of people where you have more of a team approach or different people, and so the personnel is not identical to the prior manager, or if the actual strategy is somewhat different, it's important to understand how far afield you can go with your track record, and also what kind of disclosures you need to make to be able to use a track record within an SEC rule. They often do background checks as well, as you can imagine, on principals and key employees, and this is something where any kind of resume inflation can knock you out of a deal if you're not careful. And people have gotten a lot more strict about that than maybe they were in the old days, and that's something that one should expect. You sometimes deal with people who have little regulatory glitches, let's say, in their history, and those need to be explained if you had any kind of run-in with the regulators and the like, and something that people have to deal with and be forthright about, because it's, dealing with it up front tends to be the best way to convince people that it's appropriate to back you in the business. They also want to make sure you have appropriate administrative capabilities. This, of course, is more important if they're not the ones providing them, right? This is sort of the back office. Do you have enough of the back office, or, do you have a budget that allows you to build it or hire it in from a third party? And do you have enough resources to actually have those capabilities available to you that you need? They also want to make sure, of course, you're in line with the regulatory landscape, which, as we mentioned, of course, has gotten a little bit more difficult between CFTC and SEC registration in the last few years, and something that people are very focused on to make sure that that's all well placed and that you have a compliance program. Nobody wants to have a compliance problem that hurts your fundraising ability or retention of capital, and so it's a risk mitigation standpoint. Even if you assume people are trying to do the right thing, you don't want to have inadvertent regulatory problems. They also want to make sure you have the compliance policies and procedures, and you actually got those in place. You can imagine now you're sort of thinking, gee, maybe one of these platforms where they provide this for me is probably a good idea, because there's a lot here that you have to have before you can even get the seed capital, much less, be up and operating and ready to go. And so, they want to see office space. They want to make sure that you've actually got everything in place, and ensuring you have adequate financial resources. Will the seed capital itself be enough? What's your path to profitability, or at least sustainability? We're hoping the performance fee comes through on your management fee, and those sort of projections and budgets are important, because nobody wants to back somebody and find they can't actually buy the resources they need to keep the firm going.
So have you seen, what's a typical timeline to completion of this diligence? Or does it depend on the type of seeder you're working with, or?
Depends somewhat on the type of seeder, but even the more sophisticated family offices, they go through all of this. They've gotten used to it and they figured it out. A lot of it, it's not so much the time frame for the due diligence. It's actually the time frame to try to build all of this if you're trying to build it yourself. So to get registered, get your compliance program in place, get your administrative procedures in place, not even talking about launching the fund documents, just to get that back office in place takes 4 or 5 months. You know, if you want to be up and ready to be registered and the like, it can be a time-consuming process. In the meantime, you've got to cover either your living expenses or maybe even employee expenses. So that's why some of these barrier to entry and the CEDARs have become so much more important.
Then the next set of slides, we move from sort of what the diligence is to what the structure of the seed investment might actually look like. And this first slide deals with the investment by the CEDAR in the actual investment products. And I would note that, as with many of the things we've talked about, each deal really is unique, and you can see varying levels of complexity depending on what the party's goals are and how they're striving to achieve those goals. The investment can go through one pooled investment vehicle, a fund of one, a single managed account, or it can be done through a series of funds being launched. For example, David and I worked together a couple of years ago on a structure where the CEDAR investment came through both onshore capital and offshore capital, all that rolled up into the same ultimate family office. In connection with this seed investment, you will typically see that there are certain preferential terms associated with that investment. There's an economic component, obviously, which is a potential discount on management fees or performance compensation that's largely in exchange for the early commitment and for the size of the commitment. You'll often see a most favored nation clause that effectively allows your CEDAR to take advantage of the best agreement that anyone else is ever able to negotiate with you, thereby protecting the economics that they have achieved in their negotiations with you. There's also a side on the capacity front, which is effectively an assurance to the CEDAR that your firm will have the ability to manage their current and future capital in the manner to which they expect it to be managed and to have sort of the level of service that they expect. You'll also see certain transparency rights regarding access to portfolio positions, business plans, outlook, increased meetings with management, and you can also see certain regulatory accommodations depending on who your seed investor is and how they are structured, whether they're some sort of regulated entity that might have concerns about the percentage of ownership they have in a particular fund or other disclosure-related concerns.
I think one of the things we see, too, is a big variation in those transparency rights into the portfolio. So you'll see some platforms where they want just complete transparency into what the portfolio is doing, where they want to know exactly what you're trading and they want to be able to, be able to view that and have an understanding of what kind of risks are being undertaken. Where some other CEDARs are more hands-off in the sense that they want to make sure you have good risk management and things like that, but they're not necessarily getting position-level transparency. The other thing we sometimes see is people with their rights with respect to a drawdown. So you mentioned before you don't want them to be able to back out just because of poor performance, but sometimes there's a bit of a debate, right? If there's a drawdown of X percent, right, does that give them the ability to essentially pull the plug on the seed deal? And I know we see all sorts of different terms on that, right, mm-hmm. as far as how much of a performance drawdown you can suffer before they have some rights to either de-risk the portfolio or even, essentially pull the plug.
And have you ever seen a circumstance where it's effectively splitting the difference? If we can't withdraw the capital we've already invested, but we won't be subject to customary default provisions if we fail to fund?
Yeah, you see all sorts of different combinations there, right? So it's one thing to say the money's already in the fund and I can take it out. It's another thing if I have a commitment to, say, put matching funds in for other investors, then maybe I can dial that back. You also sometimes will see the CEDARs who have those rights, but depending on the circumstances, don't necessarily exercise them, of course, right? So if you have a drawdown in the middle of a big market drawdown, maybe they're accommodating, but they'd have the contractual right to do something, but they wouldn't necessarily exercise it from that perspective. One of the terms we sometimes see is if people are going, it's one thing to change the current strategy, but one discussion with a seed investor is if you're planning to build out multiple strategies, what are their rights with respect to the strategies that you might launch in the future? Do they have some sort of right to participate in those or not? Mm-hmm. You sometimes see.
Yeah. And we would often see most of these either in the partnership agreement or in a subscription agreement. And sometimes you will see these accompanied, depending on the structure of the right, with certain disclaimers of duties either to one particular investor, to a subsequent group of investors, and sort of thereby opting out of some of the more rigorous duties that might be associated with, say, a corporation.
And do these seed investors usually come with their own set of those documents that you're referring to? Because if they're in the business of seeding, would they typically have their form that they want you to use, or is it coming from the other side?
It's been my experience that the seed platforms, where that's kind of their business, right, they almost always will have their own kind of standard terms that they want to have, and, you know, they tend to be tough negotiators on those terms. I mean, they've typically been through all sorts of different scenarios with different seed investments they've made where different problems or circumstances have arisen, and they've tried to be ready for those. And so they're pretty experienced. Will was saying one disadvantage of an experienced seeder is they've seen a lot, and so they anticipate a lot. So that can be pretty specific to the particular platform. For some of the family offices where they're not doing it as regularly, you get less uniformity.
And then on the next slide, we sort of flip the table and we look at the structure of the investment into the manager itself. And we see these typically structured in one of two different ways. The first is a direct ownership interest in the manager and or certain affiliated general partners. And when people are thinking about this sort of arrangement, they think about items such as whether the interest will be voting or non-voting. The interest generally is passive, at least in my experience. But depending on who your seeder is, you may see some number of strong minority protections. This can include consent rights over a laundry list of items that can range from changes in strategy to strategic acquisitions by the advisor to certain litigation settlements or hiring of employees at certain compensation levels. And again, most of these fundamentally will go back to an understanding by the seeder of what is the viability of the business and trying to sort of keep a manager within the fairway of a range where there is a path towards the reasonable sustainability or profitability. The other structure we often see is where the seeder obtains a revenue share. This is obviously a much more passive approach on the part of the seeder than taking in the direct ownership interest. We would typically see that these revenue shares are done on the basis of gross revenue. There are deals that are done on the basis of net revenues. My experience has been they typically take longer to negotiate and are meaningfully more complex because people have to work through how you deal with items such as one-time events or certain charges or add-backs and how that factors into the definition of what your net revenues are.
Right? Do you also see the seeder wanting to control the budget process more because they need to worry about expenses, not just revenues?
I've seen it as a mixed bag, but there's the one philosophy that it's in everyone's interest to maximize net revenues because that's sort of what the manager fundamentally, the founder takes home himself as well. But you will see provisions where, I've seen complicated provisions that actually go through how the bonus pool for employees is to work, and that if you go above the amounts calculated in that bonus pool and what you pay out to employees, then that's actually an add back to your final net revenue.
Yeah, and I've seen that too, and I think it also will depend on the nature of the seeder's investments, and I think we're going to touch more on this on this slide and the next one, but in some cases, in addition to the seed investment, there also is capital provided to the manager itself, and that's part of the equity investment I will mention before in the manager or the equity interest, which can be separate from the seed investment. I think that goes a little bit outside of the nuts and bolts category that we're in today, but we sometimes see seed investments that take two paths. One is as the anchor investor, and one is as a source of capital for the manager to get off the ground. And I think in that case, we more often will see a lot of investigation of what the budget will be and controls over the budget, especially compensation of the founders, the principals themselves, to make sure that the capital that's being provided is being used in the maximum efficiency rather than a lot of it going back as compensation. Obviously, there's a middle ground, and that's usually where you end up.
And do you see this sort of unbundling as an attempt by the seeder to basically take the best of both worlds? If we want the absolute best of being a minority investor and an investment advisor, and we want the absolute best of being a large anchor investor in a new fund?
I think it can. You know, like all of our answers here probably depends on the situation. The one I'm thinking of a few years ago, the way that I perceived it, was that they really were serving two purposes, and that one was as a seed investor, and they got, you know, preferential terms on the seed investment, like we walked through before, and the other was almost a separate, although intertwined, investment by the seeder to fund the manager in exchange for a return on their capital, which was separate, and it had more of a fixed nature to it. It wasn't net, it was gross, but we're going to get into termination of these seed arrangements on a later slide, but with anticipated shelf life of that aspect of the benefit to the seeder versus the continuing benefit of being a long-term investor in the fund.
Yeah, one of the questions we had been coming through in the our little question chat is the ADV disclosure, form ADV disclosure of these, and I think it's a good thing to point out, right? So if you have the seed investment where the money just goes into the fund, right, and you're an investor and maybe you get a share of the profit carrier or not, or maybe just get reduced fees and expenses, that's fairly simple to keep away from having to be disclosed on the ADV because you're not an investor in the manager. The ADV requires disclosure of any direct 5% owner or indirect at any level 25% owner in the investment manager itself and anyone else who in fact controls the manager. And so if you're sensitive about being disclosed on the manager's form ADV, it's important to think through whether you trigger any of those thresholds. And furthermore, those thresholds are calculated, they're very specific and technical requirements on the ADV, how you calculate, what does it mean to have 25%? And, you know, they're very specific with a partnership, it's contributed the capital or the right upon distributions or dissolution of the company or rights to profits and things like that where you've got a sort of, and voting rights, sorry, where you have to sort through it, it varies a bit by entity. And, you know, one of the things with a revenue share tends to be you're less likely sometimes to trip some of those instructions, but you do have to be very cautious of the overarching, you know, question on the ADV, which is there anyone who doesn't show up on that schedule who nonetheless controls the advisor? And so it's often an interesting kind of balance for a seed investor where they want to protect their investment, but they would prefer not to be a controlling person in the advisor, both for control person liability purposes if something were to go wrong, but also from just a general disclosure standpoint.
And then what do you see? I think practice has typically been towards more disclosure in the PPM or the operating documents about the fact that terms may differ among various investors. And are you seeing an increase in sort of really beating someone over the head with the fact that we have a seed investor and their terms are different, or do you see it as a more generic, you know, we may negotiate, we have and may in the future negotiate different terms?
You know, you see a range there. I think there's definitely been a trend toward more specificity. You know, historically, as we talked about, the seed investor providing a sort of, you know, seed investors hate to hear it as a seal of approval, but they do have sort of implicit sort of understanding that if they're willing to be a seed investor that, you know, one, the firm has the capital to get off the ground, and second, that somebody's involved. So sometimes the manager wants to disclose the seed investment. The seed investor may be less thrilled with that idea, but certainly to the extent that the seed investment might create a conflict between the fund investors and the manager because of the seed investment, those are the sorts of things that I think people are increasingly focused on disclosing because it's an obvious area for the SEC to focus on. If you have a preferential right given to a seed investor, you know, you probably want to be fairly specific about a conflict that could create with the other investors in the fund.
Absolutely. just moving along, I think we've largely covered the fact that the goal of this interest in the advisor is to obtain a share of the manager's economics, and whether it's intellectually a further discount on a management fee or whether it's viewed as sort of as a different pocket, as Josh was saying, as sort of an ownership interest that's producing its own income, the ultimate goal is to increase the overall economics to the seeder. And with that, I think Josh was going to tell us a little bit about the tax treatment of some of these arrangements.
Yeah, a few things that are worth mentioning on tax. A lot of this is obviously dependent on what the deal is that's struck. And we mentioned the three different avenues where the seeder gets its benefits. One is preferential terms on its investment, including fee discounts and information and all the things we spoke about on that topic. One is a economic interest in the manager, and when I say the term manager, I mean in the management fee, the AUM-based fee. And then the third is the economics in the general partner entity and the performance fee versus the management fee. That's not to say that in every seed deal the seeder is getting all of those things. That's the menu, I think, that we've tried to describe today, and which items on the menu are selected is a negotiated point, and so every deal will have its own differences and nuances. With respect to the latter two, the economic benefit outside of the preferential terms on the seed investment itself, the economics from the management fee and the performance amount, the tax treatment really will depend on the form of that investment and how it's taking place. And, you know, Will mentioned that we have a format that's described as just a revenue share, meaning there is a contract of some form that will give the seeder the right to a calculated mathematical amount of revenue, whether it's gross or net. Gross is obviously much simpler. Net raises a lot of questions as to how you calculate net. Alternatively, that can also be achieved through an actual equity stake in the company, in this case the management company when we're talking about the management fee, or in the case of the general partner, an equity stake in the general partner. On the management fee piece first, which is will operate differently than the general partner, so I'll speak about them separately. On the management fee, from a tax standpoint, we always focus a lot of U.S. tax lawyers on character of income, whether or not something can have a preferential rate or a non-preferential rate. Preferential rates are what people typically think of as capital gains, that for investors who are not non-corporations, so individuals, funds that have pass-through tax treatment that ultimately tier up to non-corporate investors, there is a tax savings on having capital gain versus ordinary income. The management fee, though, as the name suggests, a fee is a fee for services, and that will virtually always be characterized as ordinary income and a higher rate of tax under U.S. tax principles. Whether or not that changes is a question of congressional action, and it's hard to predict, but assuming the law doesn't change, that is the status quo. So in terms of structuring the sharing arrangement on the management fee, there is very little difference to the seeder or to the manager, whether it's structured as an equity investment or as a revenue share agreement. In either case, the seeder will get their share of the fee and will have the same tax treatment of a fee and therefore ordinary income. That can get complicated when we introduce the idea of having an offshore investor in the seed arrangement, which goes a little bit beyond the topic of nuts and bolts, and if we have time at the end, we may come back to that. But just as a cautionary warning, things do get incrementally more complicated if the source of capital is not a U.S. seeder. On the general partner side, there the economics that the seeder can benefit from is a share of the performance amount or carried interest. And whether or not that has preferential tax treatment really depends first on the investment strategy of the fund. Now, speaking about hedge funds versus other types of funds like VC funds or private equity funds, very often in those latter categories, there is a greater opportunity for preferential tax rates in the form of long-term capital gains. That's not to say that it's not available and not typical in a hedge fund, but it's more dependent on the hedge fund strategy, which again is beyond the scope of this presentation, something to think about. separately, but if the underlying investment objective and investment strategy can give rise to long-term capital gains, which are taxed at favorable rates, there's a much greater incentive on the part of the ceder to take an actual equity interest in the general partner vehicle or multiple general partner vehicles, depending on how the fund is structured. So they, as a member of the LLC or partner in the limited partnership, whatever form it may take, can get the pass-through nature of that capital gains so that they can pay a lower rate of tax, just as they do on their actual invested capital. If that's not available, then it opens up the possibility of maybe having a contractual arrangement rather than a partnership arrangement. The last item that we have here is debt, which I think is more focused on part of the conversation we touched on earlier, which is funding working capital and the like for the manager. I don't think we typically would see a debt arrangement for the GP side or the investment side, but this is really to help with the manager get off the ground. And debt has obviously a very different characterization than these other instruments under tax law. You know, basically you have the notion of having interest income rather than some type of investment return on an equity or fee stream. So those are kind of the three categories that we're focused on, and that's the highlight on tax for today.
Okay. So what is the holding period for long-term capital gains?
Long-term capital gains is 1 year, 12 months. So for a hedge fund that's investing in long equities,
right,
they're going to have a holding period of more than a year as part of their strategy, not necessarily the focal point of their strategy, it creates that opportunity.
So if you did have a portfolio that maybe 20% was long-term capital gain, it still is a benefit.
It can be, yeah. Yep. And it also gives you some additional benefit of deferral as well. When you have a share of the general partner and you do have a long-term strategy, the income recognition doesn't happen until there's a realization on those assets. So if there's a long hold period, then you would wait for that hold period to come to fruition and there's a realization event. But the performance allocation, the measurement of that is done on an annual basis, usually on an unrealized basis. So the economics are accounted for on an annual basis, even though the tax results may come later if the hold period is long enough. As a ceder, if you do have the possibility to get these longer term gains, that's another benefit to taking an equity stake. So you can also get that deferral benefit just like the general partner does and the manager does as well.
I guess we could speculate whether that's going to survive the next administration, but we've been speculating about that for the last 18 years, so I'm not sure that it's...
That's true. We'll have a whole separate session on that. Maybe one quick last thing that's not on the slide, just to mention passing, and this is more goes beyond federal tax, which is really what I was focused on. It shouldn't be ignored that state and local tax can play a big role, so obviously wherever you're manager is based, it's something to explore and look into. Myself being a New York-based lawyer, we are always very focused on the New York City unincorporated business tax, which imposes an entity-level tax on these non-corporate vehicles. And for that reason, among many others, the general partner entities and the management entities will be totally distinct structures. They may have exactly the same ownership, but they will not have a central holding company. They won't be the same entity. And that's for local tax planning. So I just throw it out there to make sure that local, state and local tax is factored in as well.
So as we come to the end of the seeding arrangement, and the end of the, going through chronologically through a seed investment here, so what happens when it's time to part ways? Or, you know, if you want to part ways, how would you do that? So this kind of assumes that things have worked well, right? Obviously, if the firm doesn't do well, you know, there's no buyout. If there's a falling out or a regulatory problem that causes a cancellation, that's a very different kind of termination. This is sort of, you know, you've been seeded by an investor. You're now 5 or 10 years out. You're very successful. You've built a big firm. At some point, you know, should their investment or their share of your revenue or your carry, should that be decreased or even removed, right? At some point, the value they added at the very beginning, they've realized probably a lot of that as they've shared fees and maybe even the performance fee going through the life of the fund, and at some point they've been fairly compensated. Now that's a negotiating point about when that point is, and you sometimes see a manager buy outright where you would have the ability to have the manager buy out the interest of the seed investment. This would typically be if the investment's directly in the management company. If they're in the fund, you're usually happy if they stick around. Typically, those fees would stay. Their preferential fees may go in perpetuity. You may not allow them to put a lot more money in under those terms, but whatever their initial investment is, you tend to see that be more sort of an indefinite thing because it is good capital to have in the fund. This is more the management company side. Sometimes there's a sunset, a predetermined amount of time where you share revenues and the like, and after, you know, 3, 5, 10 years, whatever it is, the revenue either ratchets down or, you know, ceases altogether in recognition of kind of the trajectory of the firm. Then you can have a forced sale. You can have a right, so a put or call option, basically, on either side to force a sale. So the seeder might be looking for liquidity, and the management company is unlikely to go public or otherwise have a sale transaction, and they want to get more money out, not just their stream of either net profits or revenues. They might actually want to get an actual sale back to the company. So that's something you see sometimes as well. Oftentimes, I don't know your experience, Will, but my experience, a lot of times these buyout rights you negotiate at the beginning are kind of the start of the negotiation after they become successful about what the real terms are going to be of the buyout, which often can vary from what was negotiated up front.
Yes, I agree. I think everyone is very focused on pre-agreeing what the structure might be, whether it's an EBITDA-based metric or some other multiple. But when the time comes to actually exercise, I think you see the parties come back to the table to say, well, actually, this doesn't make any sense because the trajectory is going, you know, it's flat and we'd expect it more of a growth equity business, you know, for the manager. Or, you know, the number works out to something that I, as the manager, I want to buy you out, but I can't finance it in this way. So perhaps you have an earnout, or I'm going to need to get a credit facility to be able to, you know, actually be able to engage in this. So I think you do see people come back to the table.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So the final part of terminating, you know, winding down the investment vehicles, you can sometimes have rights, you know, even after the manager goes away. You know, the seeder and its principals may have non-compete and similar arrangements to keep them from competing with the successor firm, and have an interest in the seeder could end up with an interest in the successor firm when the principals leave. And I think here, you know, when you first look at this, you say that seems kind of radical, right? You're sort of following these poor people around and taking money from them even after they've left the company. And it sounds like something that shouldn't be permitted. But I think what the seeders have found is if they're not careful with this, it's possible for principals to simply, you know, wind down one management company one day and then turn the lights back on and say they're a different management company the next and effectively escape any of the tail kind of economics that were otherwise negotiated. So when you see these done in ways that are really fair, it's really meant to be kind of an anti-circumvention. You can't just walk away from your management company and start a new one, you know, and take all of the value that's been created and profit from it without sort of living up to your deal with the seed investor. That's usually what, you know, these things probably should be designed to do so that people are getting the benefits of the deal they thought they had.
That's analogous to a non-compete.
Right. Of course, non-competes can be very difficult to enforce,
right,
but, you know, that's to be decided, you know, at the time as they go through the process. So maybe go on to the final slide. We'll take a few. We have we had a number of questions come up, and we've got just a few minutes left here before the top of the hour. We do like to end on time so people can get on with their schedules. So I've got had a couple of questions I thought I would throw out and see if my other panelists have questions they want to address. One of the questions that came up was, you know, preferential transparency rights for the seed investor. How does that square with the SEC's, you know, sort of pronouncements from the staff about, you know, concern about preferential information rights for certain investors over others, right? And I think that's important. That's certainly an important issue to manage in the sense that you do need to worry about what kind of conflict that preferential information would potentially create. And, you know, on a day-to-day basis, it doesn't create huge conflicts, although I think the principle now most people try to move toward is equality of information among investors. Where the issue really becomes a question is the time when the investor decides they want to withdraw capital. Because if they have better portfolio transparency than the other investors, and they go to withdraw their capital and they know something, now hopefully if the NAV is being struck correctly, it's mitigated, but it's not impossible. There have been cases, usually where the NAV, and sometimes with registered funds, where the NAV was probably overstated and the person withdrawing probably knew that. Those are the allegations. So things like that. But the CEDR, I think, should be very focused on the idea they're putting themselves in an awkward position if they want to take money out of the fund, if they know more than the other investors. They really need to manage that process in a way where they can demonstrate that they divided it, whether it's a sale plan or some other method to try to be careful about the insider trading and conflict issues, and certainly a disclosure issue. One of the other questions we had was, is there a level of ownership that by the seed investor that might bring the new hedge fund under sort of their regulatory umbrella, right? Is there some sort of, you know, at what point do they effectively become like an affiliate, right, where they have to be under the same regulatory umbrella? I think there, you know, there's a couple of different regulatory regimes to think about when you think about that. One is, you know, from the SEC perspective, we talked a little bit about the ADV disclosure at the 5 and 25% kind of control level. And there are a lot of issues under the Advisors Act where you have a lot of disclosure if you're under common control. So if the CEDR controlled two hedge funds, those hedge funds are now under common control with one another. That can complicate life quite a bit, potentially. And so people try to manage that process. Another one that people, you know, should keep their eye on is, you know, if there's a bank holding company in the picture where, you know, having too much of an ownership interest, certainly in the management company, could trigger bank holding company status at a control level, and it's a complicated test, but as long as the Volcker rule is still on the books, that's a very dramatic change for a manager to suddenly be pulled into to Volcker rule compliance, which would be, again, as long as it's still on the books, it's a big issue if you're trying to manage money. Manageable for some people, but a big change for somebody who's not used to being under it.
Yeah. And one of the other questions we've seen is the different ways to calculate net revenue. And I probably should have specified at the time that it's a contractual net revenue, so it's effectively a synthetic number. You know, GAAP is GAAP, and that's sort of what the books will say is your net revenue. But in determining a net revenue share, there's sometimes theoretical assumptions that are done to sort of back into it, and much in the same way you would see add-backs and modifications to EBITDA on a credit agreement that is purely contractual and has nothing to do with what your actual net revenue is. It really deals with what the contractual negotiation between the parties is as to sort of what is an allowable deduction from your gross revenue.
I would think the startup expenses is probably a big point of negotiation on that and how you spread those out, even though they're all fixed upfront costs. I think a lot of times the calculating net revenue, the CEDR's not going to be willing to let that all hit at once, and we'll want that spread out.
Exactly.
You end up negotiated point over how many years do you spread that across your revenues, even though from a GAAP standpoint there might be a certain rule, that doesn't mean the CEDR is going to want to apply that rule for determining their net revenue.
Exactly. We've seen that. Is it, you would know better than I, but there's 5 years or whatever that you capitalize some of the expenses over, and you know there are instances where people have wanted to delay that to 10 years to sort of decrease the amount, and there's been other times where people have wanted to accelerate it because they're willing to take the hit on day one.
Next slide. So I'd like to thank my co-presenters, Will and Josh, here for the presentation, and mention our next upcoming webinars in the series, Prime Brokerage and Financing, in March on the 8th, and on April 12th, Derivatives and the CFTC.